Northern Ireland in the late 50s and early 60s was the perfect breeding ground for the show bands. They toured extensively and gave their audiences the undemanding dance music they wanted. There was no hint of the teenage rebellion to come. This was music your mother could listen to, and often did. The names were magical: Tina and the Mexicans, Derek and the Sounds, the Miami Show Band, the College Boys. But the rules were rigid and the attitudes were conservative. The work was well paid, but there was no room for originality. You're always too busy selling morning papers and money. The songs the show bands performed were often written by somebody else, and the bands sacrificed their musical identity to the point where they wore the same suits, played the same circuit, and reveled in the fact that they were the undisputed stars of the music scene, north and south. But the show bands had another role, nurturing talent, which would eventually have a wider impact. A group called the Monarchs had a young saxophonist called Van Morrison and a bass player called George Jones.
Show bands had that respectability that everybody loved them, even ministers and priests. Well, as you know, priests themselves ran most of the dances right through Ireland. But they had that air of steadiness, a platform, a guaranteed wage, and it was a job.
I was around certainly for the Maritime, and I used to play there quite regular. And I saw the original them there, and Rory Gallagher when he first came down here, and so on. So I was around there. But it was still a very, very small minority. The show bands were still the number one man, you know. And they still were till about another 7 or 8 years, you know. They kept going. People liked show bands. It's a little Ole from
Pasadena. The Irish charts of the time were more likely to contain a Beach Boys song covered by the Freshmen than to have the original. Indeed, these songs produced some of the biggest hits on the island. But the atmosphere was stifling for those who wanted to do anything original. The audiences were still crying out for the old favourites, and for Gerry Anderson, then a member of the Chessmen, that was the most frustrating thing about the show bands.
Show bands, I think, were the worst thing that ever invented in Ireland. One of the reasons I think that is because a lot of musicians who were very good and who were very talented were actually stopped from using that creativity and the talent. They were disencouraged to write their own songs, and they were offered fistfuls of money to do things that they hated. And it's very hard, if you have no money, to refuse to accept fistfuls of money. A number of names spring to mind. For instance, I thought the most talented guy ever come out of Northern Ireland in particular was Billy Brown. Billy Brown had more talent in his little finger than nearly anyone I knew. But Billy was offered a lot of money and he did very well, and there was no spur for him to do his own stuff. And he was full of ideas and used to do it every once in a while, but they travelled all the time, he had no time to develop stuff. The managers actually discouraged you. They just wanted you to do covers, do them as well as you could. And I think possibly in a way that they stifled a lot of talent in Ireland.
I mean, the show bands were making good money at the time, but then they had to expand the whole of the island. They were playing all over Ireland and outside of Ireland. But the beat group boom, as it was, would have been called then, with beat groups, that was a new thing. A lot of promoters in the Irish circuit were a bit reluctant to pay that sort of money when they were only getting four people, whereby the night before they were paying the same sort of money and getting 10 or 12 people. And that's the way they looked at it. You were paid by how many people were in your band. I mean, lots of occasions guys would bring their mate along just to stand in the band and hold a saxophone so they'd get more money. The guy couldn't play the wireless.
Groups weren't getting big halls. They were confined to the show bands. All they could be content with was playing warm-up to the big bands like the Royal, Joe Dolan, or even Dave Glover and stuff like that. I remember a perfect example of us playing in the Arcadia in Cork, and we normally used to go in early, sit up in the balcony and watch the warm-up band. And we'd been out for, had a jar, would come in, and the place was packed. Dave Glover in those days was massive down in Cork. Walked up to the balcony and heard this amazing sound of guitars. And the place was bunged right around the stage. And this young kid was running around the stage with long hair, whizzing up and down a guitar like I'd never seen in my life. And that was Rory Gallagher and Taste, before he'd even come up north, never mind went to England. And would you believe it, he was doing his nut, the sweat was pouring off, and he was playing licks like I'd never seen in my life. And the crowd were around the front shouting, "We want Glover." And I mean, that's what the groups were confined to in those days, being warm-up.
One of the groups to emerge into this largely indifferent market was Thin Lizzy, featuring a young guitarist from Belfast, Eric Bell.
I remember one of the first gigs Thin Lizzy ever did was in a show band hall somewhere in Leitrim or something. And there was a show band on and we were doing their break. And I'll never forget it. It was about our fourth gig ever, like Thin Lizzy. And when we walked out on the stage, people just laughed. They really did. I couldn't believe it. We just walked out. The show band was on before us. We walked out and the three of us were like three creatures from the Black Lagoon, you know. Phil had a big afro and the earrings, and I was standing there with a beard and my hair out of the hair and so on, you know. And people just stopped dancing. They all came up to the front of the stage and were pointing up at us and laughing, you know. And that's what it was like.
Take the guys who were working in what we used to call the beat groups. Do you remember those days? Well, there was people. I remember people like Gary Moore and Phil Lynott, who were totally penniless. And they were talented guys, but probably no more talented than some of the guys that we played in bands with. And we'd be in a pub, and I'd be talking to Phil Lynott, I'd be talking to Gary Moore, and I used to actually kind of feel sorry for them, because we had loads of money, and they didn't. But they chose not to go into the show band thing, and we used to think that was quite odd, because we thought that they were silly, because we had been conditioned in such a way that to be in a show band and make loads of money was the thing that you do. The music was behind it. We thought we were getting as much satisfaction as you could get from doing good covers of songs. So in actual fact, we were indoctrinated in such a way that we weren't encouraged to think at all. So we began to believe that what we were doing was the best, and that those guys and groups were wasting their time because they weren't earning any money.
If you were in a group, it was like, you know, I'm a real musician. I'm suffering for my art, you know. I'm not getting 40 quid a week in a free suit. I'm starving for what I'm doing, and I have to do a day job, and I have to play at night and so on. And show bands would respect group musicians because some of them were better musicians, but they looked down on them as well because group musicians had no money. They hadn't got cars. They hadn't got flashy girlfriends. Whereas show band members had, you know. Show band members used to go out at night and they had the tan fastic on and the hair all lacquered, looking like $1 million, a flash car, money to spend. And you had the two extremes.
But the show bands did, some of the bands were great, some great players within the bands, but to be fair, they had to do like 5-hour sets and even 3-hour sets, but then you get visiting bands from Britain, you know, you get we supported the Animals and Swingin' Blue Jeans and people like that. So it wasn't all bad, but I mean, I knew ultimately it was just like a crash course, really, just to learn music and or to get out on the stage, you know.
Because I was like well involved with show bands, and that's the only trick I knew, you know, was to, and the beat, as it was called then, the beat groups and them and the Mad Lads and all that. I mean, that was something, that was the stepping off point before going to England, you know. And if you were in a show band, then it was miles away.
Bands leaving this country to go to England tended to be, for their time, very well organized. They would have played enough to have been professionals, which wasn't really an option in England. It was only an option for 1% in England. And people left here with things like PA systems, vans, instruments that were paid for, and then went to try and make it in England. And it was really the schooling and the basic opportunity and groundwork that existed in Northern Ireland that gave them the launching pad to be able to go to England as nearly a finished product.
I never had a great love for show bands. I mean, we used to do support sometimes for show bands, but it was amazing the halls you played, like around the countryside, places like Arglass. I mean, I can remember playing one night with one of the top show bands, and we did the first hour, and for the first hour, not one person danced. We were doing all this blues music, and they were sitting there, and nobody moved. And as soon as the show band came on and struck up, dun, 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 everybody's on the floor. Like, it was like free money on the floor. You know, you couldn't get them off the floor. But we had that reception where we went, you know. So I never did like show bands, I'll be honest with you.
Look at the sunshine. Look at the sunshine. It's an
Most musicians might have harbored other ambitions, but they often stayed with the show bands simply to make a living. For years, the show bands retained their tenacious grip on the music scene on both sides of the border. Their uniform poses still dominated the pages of the music magazines. Their names continued to occupy the entertainment columns of the newspapers. But their days were numbered. Now it was just a matter of time before the originality so despised by the show bands and their supporters began to break through. Musicians like Van Morrison, a young Eric Bell, and future guitar legend Gary Moore were about to use them as a launching pad to stardom.
As opposed to being like a blues guitar player, or I was adaptable, and I was able to, through the show band thing, you know, and having to play all the bits and pieces. Locked in and we can't get out. Locked in and we can't get out. We're locked in and we can't get out. Locked in and we can't get out. Yeah. What's that you got there? Cause that's wild, dangerous. How the hell would you know and where you're from? Just round the corner and I'm away home. Sammy's on the corner. Mickey's in the pub. Ding-a-dong, a right royal battle. Rub-a-dub-dub-dub, it just might be a dub. When it rains a little pain, no need to suffer in vain. Take to the streets with your music so sweetly. Built to this country, such a sad refrain. Singing, locked in when we can't get out. Locked in when we can't get out. Locked in when we can't get out. Locked in. Sweet Jesus, Joe and Mary, come on down here, cause we're all going crazy. Guns and fertilizer, there's boys on the run. Bombs and bullets flying, and there's nowhere to run to. Sammy's on the corner, big Sammy. Mickey's in the pub. Take it on the right royal battle. Rub a dub, don't give up, it might be a dub. Cry when it rains a little pain. No need to suffer in vain. Take to the streets with your music so sweetly. To live to this country, such a sad refrain. Locked in and we can't get out. Locked in and we can't get out. But locked in and we can't get out. Locked in and we can't get out. Locked in, 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 we can't get out.
Didn't kind of get out. There was a lot of groups like ourselves went away to the continent, and we met up with American GIs because Van was in the band. He was a very quiet sort of young lad, very creative even in those days, but being we in these records, we're all coloured guys like Memphis Slim and Blind Boy Fuller and all this, and John Lee Hooker. Van, because he'd never been out of Belfast, had never seen a coloured guy. When we went to Germany, he saw these American GIs, coloured guys, and he couldn't believe it. And he just was attracted to them like a moth around a flame. We had been playing earlier blues stuff, Ray Charles, things like that. But once we met these guys, they were saying, hey man, you gotta be into this stuff. They bring us around records, and Van was the main influence in the band. Yeah, let's play this, let's play this. We were suddenly playing all this stuff, which we really got into because we got two saxes in the band, an old overthrow from a show band. And we were putting them to good use. When we left the Southern sector, the American sector as they called it, to other clubs up north, we were confronted by these groups called the Searchers, the Swing and Blue Jeans, the Beatles, who were playing so-called R&B. But we had been playing the original stuff in the southern part of Germany. When we went up to there, that didn't go down at all in the clubs. We had to copy the Swing and Blue Jeans and the Beatles and their version of it to go down with the crowd. So it was like a changing circle. We were back to copying again. Same idea. But when the groups who went to Germany came home, they had still got this idea of blues in their head. And they started changing the people of Belfast, especially the young kids in those days, with places like Sammy Houston's and the Maritime and stuff like that. The blues is the thing, and that's where it was born. Wow, here it
comes. By the mid-60s, the blues had arrived. With its raw, distinctive style, it answered the call of a new generation. Before the end of the decade, night would begin to descend on the heyday of the show bands.
I was basically rock and roll and rhythm and blues orientated, country and western as well. You remember with the show bands, Terry, you had to play everything, anything and everything. I got two fellas, Ronnie Millings and Alan Henderson. We put the Gamblers together and we were playing what we wanted to play at the time, which wasn't really awfully popular. That moved on like that. We got Eric Rickson keyboards, and then Van, he had been playing with the Monarch show band, the show band scene. We'd known Van for a lot of years, although we'd never played together apart from a couple of times I'd played with the Monarchs. Van came along, he had a better blues influence than any of us. You know, because obviously his father had one of the best collections of blues are aware, you know that yourself anyway. So he put a heavier blues influence into it. It moved on from the Gamblers to become them.
We were used to show bands, and we had to be in the first line, not just a miniature show band or a five-piece show band, but to be something totally different and identifiable as totally different from show bands or their offshoots.
We grew our hair to attract attention. Stopped wearing band uniforms. You know, we had the show bands. Here's, you know, all guys all dressed the same. Super musicians. But it was all copyist and there was no originality. And, you know, A, B, C, D, everybody looked the same. That was the way it was until the groups came along.
I think the R&B bands at the time were rebelling against anything that you could rebel against. I mean, it was mid-60s and the youth of the world was in rebellion. I think it was just another facet of rebellion. You saw it in other art forms, you saw it in various cultural forms. It was rebellion time. Certainly, the R&B bands of the time took it a little further than other people, but it was part of the 60s.
I was with a show band that sort of, you know, started playing rhythm and blues, and we went to Germany for 4 months. And right after that, I stopped through London, and there was a place called the Ken Collier Club. And there was like a group in the basement, and they were playing all this sort of music that I'd been listening to for a long time because, you know, my father had a lot of blues records, and I heard quite a bit early on. And you know, I heard this band playing in a basement in Soho. You know, small room just about from here to there. That was the size of the place. And I thought, well, if they can do it, then I can do it. Because, I mean, there was only about 20 people in there, but, you know, it was great vibes. So I thought, you know, I'd like to do this in Belfast. So we went around and looked for a place and found the Maritime, you know, Union Hall. I started putting gigs on there.
The Maritime was, to me, it was just like the Garden of Eden. You know, I mean, that's the way I could put it. Where so many good things happened there. You know, and it just spread out, and people heard about it and said, well, we've got to go and see this Maritime. So they came to Maritime. When they come to Maritime, then they got hooked as well. And it just spread out, you know, and I mean, there was nothing fancy about the Maritime. It was just a brick building. I mean, as I say, it was painted horrible green colour. It was a rotten. But what it was the birthplace for the blues in Northern Ireland. And that's, you know, that's where it all started.
It's something to eat and... Oh yes, oh yes, oh yes, I might even wash my hair and what the fuck is left of it.
All right.
All right. 1, 2, 3, 4.
We'll be right back.